Hey everyone, Michael Antonovich with Swap Moto Live here for another installment of the Midweek Podcast presented by Yoshimura. For this one, we talk with Alec Gaut, a hardworking member of the logistics teams that handle the on-track appearance and safety processes for Supercross and Pro Motocross. Tour life is a dream for the Kansas native, as he's been able to visit parts of the U.S., watch the action up close, and become friends with his co-workers and people in the pit area. But it's not the easiest gig. Gaut and the crew spend most of the year on the road, a schedule that puts him in a new city at the start of each week and requires days to get a venue ready. Flights are necessary to get to each Supercross, while Pro Motocross is a summer-long road trip in a van. As good as Gaut is at being a flagger, he's hopeful the time on the road may lead to another position in the industry, preferably something in media. He's done camera work before, both as an aspiring freelancer and as part of Racer TV's production team, and plenty of his shots from Friday's media sessions were shared by racers this Supercross season. The hour with Alec was fun and motivating, as he's a true fan who's found an essential role for himself when things were uncertain. You can find him and more of his work on Instagram at Alec Gaut, A-L-E-C-G-A-U-T. You already know that Yoshimura makes the best exhaust options for Honda motocross and off-road bikes, but they make great power for your Yamaha, Kawasaki, KTM, Husqvarna, and GasGas too. Yoshimura has been delivering power since 1954 and can make your bike run and sound the best it can. Visit them at yoshimura-rd.com to see how they can make your bike bark. All right, Alec, so it's good to see you, bud. I know that you've had a whirlwind, 17 races in 18 weeks. This is what I wanted to talk to you about, is because you see it all. You do it all. You do it differently than everybody else does. You know, a lot of us fly in on the weekend and we just see how nice the track looks on Friday for press day and then Saturday night. But man, you guys get there really Tuesday, Wednesday and just start going to town. So I'm excited to see kind of how everything in this interview goes and like all the stories that you have from 2-3 years on the road now. So give me a little bit of background on who you are and really where you're at right now.
Well, I appreciate you having me.
Of course.
I'm Alec Gaut. I'm one of the track crew members. I do outdoors and Supercross. I kind of got my start just doing video stuff, and you might remember me back a couple years ago just like hitting you up about video stuff. I would email teams and riders to see if I could get with them and do some video stuff, you know, behind the scenes. And I worked for Racer TV for a couple seasons for the ATV stuff. Used to race ATVs. I know everybody, you know, gives me crap for that, but that's how I got my start. And started doing video stuff, and then it just got to a point where it was like I was working two jobs, working 7 days a week, but I would have to take off to go to the races on the weekends, and basically just a weekend warrior. And I would drive all night to get back to work at the real job. And it just got to a point where I was like, man, like I really need to figure something out. Like I've always wanted to be in the industry, and but I still want to stay in my hometown area. And so it's been tough, but it just got to a point like when COVID hit, I was working like crazy, and I was just like, okay, I've got to find something. And I emailed Davey Coombs and was like, hey, do you guys have any projects coming up for outdoors? Like, is there any way that I can help? And I got a phone call maybe 5 minutes later, and it was John Ayers Jr. with Gear Services, and he offered me a spot with outdoors. And I mean, it's something I've always wanted, but as soon as I got that call, like, whoa, like this is real now. Like I have a chance to go to all the races that I've spent all my money going to, you know, in the past. So I accepted the job offer. And then this was like right when COVID was getting big. And so I accepted the job offer, and I dreaded having to tell my company that I was working at. I worked there for 5 years, and I had to let them know like I'm about to start traveling. And so it was like a few days after I told my company that I was leaving, and they postponed the series. And
oh,
because it was supposed to start, it was supposed to start in May, And then I can't remember when it actually started, but I told them, and I was like pretty much giving them my 2 weeks. And then I get, you know, checking the websites, and it's like the races are postponed. It's like, oh God, like, what did I do? Like, am I going to lose, you know?
Dude, and on top of everything at that time anyway, like, oh my gosh. Yeah.
And I'm talking with my boss, John, and he's like, yeah, like the race, it's going to be fine. Like, we're going to have races. It's fine. And then it moved to June, and it's like, okay. And they're cool to keep me on until then. And then it was postponed again. I was like, oh my God, like I finally get my opportunity and it's getting taken away from me before I even get to go to a race. But it worked out, and did my first outdoor season, and it was awesome. I mean, I had never been away from home for that long, and it was a crazy experience. I mean, getting to go to all those races that I've always dreamed about, you know, I always read the reports and check out photos and all that stuff, videos from these races, and I finally get to be there. So after that, I worked the outdoor season, and I was like, I wonder if I can do the Supercross season, and kept beating on doors and just talking to the people that I met throughout the series of the outdoors, and it just, I'm still going. So
So I was looking through my phone yesterday, just trying to line everything up for today. And I saw the message that you sent me in like November of 2020 that you got the call to do Supercross in 21.
Yep.
And that's like the big one. You know, 21 was a big deal for you guys because it was trying to go back to normalcy. And as that was your first time, you know, there was an understaffed issue for everybody on that series. But then you guys did have a few people had to, you know, miss rounds. There was a lot of issues, but I mean, trial by fire for you to learn that first 2021 Supercross season. How was that year just to get your feet wet?
It was crazy. I mean, like you said, like we had some guys missing in action, like for a few of the rounds. I mean, looking back, I remember I think it was Indianapolis, and we had a bunch of guys test and they had to quarantine, and we have our morning meetings, and it was like 8 o'clock, and I get there and I'm looking around, there's not many people there, and our manager is just like, well, this is what we have. We have to put a show together for Saturday. I'm looking around, there's like 6 or 7 guys.
Yeah.
And I'm like, we normally have 20 some people to, you know, build everything, get everything set up. So my boss Bill, he was making calls all day, just calling, you know, people that have worked there in the past, like, can you work for this week? Like, we're in a pinch, like, we need something, you know, and just things like that. It's crazy to think that we pulled it off with that amount of people. I mean, we ended up getting more people, but it was just like, you know, the cards were stacked against us, and we were so.
And you're at weekend two. You're weekend two, and you're just like, oh my God, I have so many more of these to do.
Yeah. But yeah, it was crazy.
Okay, so I didn't know that you did racer TV stuff for the quad nationals. So that's pretty cool. I didn't know that. There's somebody else, John Cuzzo, that does 100% stuff. And John did a lot of, like, you know, laying the cables for NBC stuff. There's a lot of guys that do a lot of those groundwork jobs. So what does that job entail? Like, what does that first, you know, pro motocross for the ATV side? What are you doing to get your foot in the door there?
For me, like, I was like racing quads and taking video of just like other guys, like helping out with sponsorships and stuff.
So you were full media guy then?
What's that?
Were you like media guy then, like trying to be media guy and racer at the same time?
Right, trying to be. And I applied for Racer TV, and I was just a camera operator for them. Okay. So like I would just help with backup footage, and then my producer, Gloop, he would put the shows together. So it was like the full show for the ATV side of things. And I got my first gig, and it was in Georgia. And I remember they were telling me, like, you know, you're responsible for getting to the race and all this stuff, and like, we'll pay for your fuel and all that. Like, all right, cool. Well, it was in Georgia, so it was like a 14-hour drive. They thought I was a lot closer than that. I don't know. I just remember them asking me, like, how long did it take you to get here? And I was like, 14 hours. And I'm like, what? Like, you drove all this way to be here. I'm like, I want to be here. Like, this is, but, yeah, it was awesome. I did a bunch of races for them. And, I knew a lot of the racers just from being there. So it was pretty cool to be able to interview them and do stuff like that. So, yeah, that just kind of grew into something that I just wanted to keep doing. And I got on the dirt bike side as well, helping the Crossland Honda team from a few years ago. I helped them with a sponsor video, and that led to a lot of other cool stuff that I got to be a part of. So,
Okay. On the quad thing. Cause like you even joke like, oh, you know, a quad guy or whatever, but like, I think it's cool. Cause like even where we're at, you're in Kansas, I'm in Illinois, dude, everybody rides quads. Everybody's got some kind of four wheeler, either like something that they go hunting with or on the farm, or they got, you know, a race quad or their cousin has one or whatever. What got you into quads? Why quads over dirt bikes?
My cousin and I, we just rode around. It was mostly like trail riding and stuff. And then he decided to do a motocross race in Oklahoma. And I went to go watch that. And after that, I was hooked, man. I was like, I want to be a part of this. And so we started racing a bunch of local races. And it's cool because, like, thinking back, like when I was doing local arena crosses and stuff, there's guys like Colt Nichols and I mean, they were little. I mean, we were, I feel like I'm so much older than them. I'm really not, but it's just like watching them race. It was like, I remember watching the Hahn brothers and like winning Dash for Cash races and stuff at our local races. But yeah, I just kind of got into quads and just raced that, which I never raced dirt bikes, but I do ride every now and then. So.
Okay. The media side, I know, like the Crossland thing, that's how I remember meeting you for the first time. I remember seeing you around the pits there, especially at like the Midwest races, like Dallas or St. Louis, wherever we'd be, I would always see you there with camera in hand. I'm like, okay, I'll keep tabs on that guy. And you know, there's tons of dudes, especially now more than ever, as cameras have been easier to pick up and there's more stuff out there, more software and YouTube and all that. It's always cool to see you independent guys like kind of crack the scene, because when I had to do it in 2009, God, it was fucking hard. Like, it was terrible, you know, but I was so lucky that I got in with Don the way that I did. But it was the same thing. Like, I lived in St. Louis, we would drive to Spring Creek or we drive to Redbud, and I'd kind of like fluff my way through, like, oh yeah, I was gonna go to that race anyway, and then, you know, wasn't, and then have to like pull all my money together to travel there at the last minute, drive 15 hours like you.
Yep.
So like, to know that you were doing all of that groundwork stuff to make that happen, what was it about the media side that you're like, that's what I want to do?
I've always just been like a fan of the behind the scenes stuff. I mean, I love riding videos and everything, but I always liked hearing the backstories of just like, you know, the riders and what they had to go through and stuff like that. But yeah, I don't know, for some reason I was always just glued to videos and photos of just like the races and stuff, and always wanted to be a part of it and just kind of stuck with it. So
Okay, when it came time to know that you got to get your foot in the door somehow, what made you decide I'm going to try to go this way? Like, to have Davey call you right back and John Ayers call you right back that fast, I mean, that's pretty good luck, especially considering the circumstances. So great on you to know the situation at that time. But what led to you going like, I have to do this now. Like, this is my time where I have to put everything on the line to take this chance to get the career that I want right now.
Yeah. I mean, I've been doing this for a really long time and just like trying everything I can to be a part of a team or, you know, it's just some way to be in the industry. And it was just like, I was working it during the COVID times. I was working like crazy at this warehouse doing sign work, and it just kind of got to a point where I was like pretty much just overworked, and I was like, you know what, like, I'm not happy doing this all the time. I mean, I'm working 7 days a week and, you know, trying to do video stuff on top of that, like after work, and I was just tired of it. And just got to a point where I was like, you have to do this, like, you have to at least just, you know, give it a shot and see if there's any opening. I mean, it's not going to hurt to ask. So yeah, I emailed Davey and got a call back right after that. And I was just like, okay, it's getting real now. Like, I have an opportunity. Like, let's go.
Mm-hmm. That first summer, like, I honestly, as tough as 2020 was and just weird, like, to go do Utah, how we did it, and, like, you know, not knowing what we could do or couldn't do, and then being at the races, but getting to see that. And then that break, like you said, between Supercross ending and knowing the Nationals are going to start, but when are they going to start? There was that lull. But once we finally got to the races that year, I think that will go down as probably my favorite year of racing ever. That summer was incredible to go to Loretta's those two times that we did. And then, you know, Red Bud completely empty. And then we see Millville in, you know, the first couple weeks of autumn in the north, like mid northwest, is just beautiful.
Yeah.
You go to Paula, like, that was just such a memorable time. And I think back to, like, just how pretty the tracks looked and how excited the fans were to be there and how guys were just going for it, because, like, everybody was racing like their life was on the line.
Yep.
How fun was that for you to see that firsthand, but then also understand all the work that you had to do, because then you were seeing, like, how much travel it was and how long the days were when you're at the track working.
Yeah. It was an eye opener for sure. I mean, you go to those races as a spectator or even as a media guy, like, you don't realize, like, you look around and it's like, I guess you just don't pay attention to, like,
because it's a finished product. Yeah.
Yeah. You don't pay attention to, like, all the structures and everything. And so once I started getting into that side of things, it was like, wow, like, this is a lot of stuff, like all the arches and, you know, the podium, stuff like that. It's just like, man, this is crazy. And all the banners, all the repeater banner, like, I have to go around and pound stakes around the whole entire track to put that banner up. And it's just like, wow, like, this is a lot.
Mm-hmm. Dude, it's a lot. The stakes alone, the wooden stakes with the hammer, and then you guys got to hit it with the nail gun, the handheld nail gun. Like, that, you guys' hands have to be just cooked by the end of a Thursday.
But, yeah, I mean, just getting to travel to all those races, like, for outdoors, it's a bunch of guys loaded up in a sprinter van. And, you know, doesn't sound that exciting, but, I mean, for all of us, like, we all love moto, and just getting to see different sites and, you know, you get to see the entire country just driving around. So it's pretty cool.
There's this thing, you know, because I see everybody in the pits every weekend, and it's so fun. Like, everybody knows how much fun the races are and how much I love them on weekends, just like you. But to see everybody and know where everybody's coming from and getting to know all these guys at every position from top to bottom, I've had a really fun time getting to know a lot of those guys that are on the track crew because of what you said. Like, you guys are so into it and you see everything and you guys spend every single day in the car or working bench racing about it. So you guys are the core fan. What's that group of guys like? Like, how many is it in the van, and what's that routine?
I'd say there's probably, like, last year there was like six guys in the van or something like that. But there's also a few other guys that ride with, you know, maybe one of the truck drivers, or they fly in or something like that. But yeah, it's just like, last season we had Jordan Post. He was a photographer, or he is a photographer, really good. And he rode with us, so, like, we kind of connected with camera stuff. And I mean, there's Cal, he's the driver, which he does both outdoors and Supercross. And you know, it's just like, it's cool because, like, we have a lot of things in common. A lot of the crew, like, wants to go to skate parks and stuff, like, when we got time off, and I like taking pictures of that stuff. And so, I don't know, it's just like a good group of guys that love moto, and it's our lives. So
Okay, you said the driver. Do you guys switch driving, or is it just one dude just mo-dogging, like, all of it?
For the most part, Cal does most of the driving. So, like, I switch off from time to time. I help him out when I can, which it's awesome when he's driving, because after I take pictures on race day, like, we have to tear down and everything, so I don't have time to, like, really sort through photos. So we usually have a long drive, so I can just sit in the passenger seat and sort through all my stuff and start sending pictures out. But for the most part, he does the driving, and we do switch off from time to time. But
okay, so let's get into the actual, like, nitty-gritty of the work, especially between the two series. What is what's a build day like for you guys at the Nationals? Like, what's a work weekend like at the Nationals? What do you have to do? What day do you get there? How's the workload start? How long are these hours? And then when are you done on Saturday night?
Yeah, so we get started early in the week. It's usually like Tuesday or Wednesday we'll start. Yeah, it's Wednesday we'll start for outdoors. And we just start unloading the trucks. And then we start laying out the arches and get that stuff ready. We do mechanics tents and all that. And a lot of the VIP tents, I help set up with stuff like that too. There's like the media center and trying to think, we got all kinds of stuff going on, but like I also do the live feed for the VIP tents. I set up all the TVs and stuff for the VIP areas, and I also do the parking. So like right when we get there, I start doing the start laying out the cones for all the pro pits
and stuff, and then like painting that. And all that.
Yep.
Damn.
Yeah.
That's day one. That's like the first few days. That's before you've even touched a track.
Yep. So we start doing that, which I just started that last season. And the idea was that I was going to be trained to do all that and, you know, take it on this season. And it just happened to be like, I think it was two rounds in, and senior was going on a bike ride and ended up breaking both of his legs.
I remember that.
He's the one that's supposed to be training me. And so like the next morning they had the morning meeting, and it was like, yeah, he broke both of his legs, and so he won't be here. And I'm just like, okay.
That was at Colorado, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Or going into Colorado. Yeah. Because then you guys were like, because then his son had taken over a bunch of stuff, and I was like, ooh, John Harris Sr. is like busted up like that. These guys are down like a workhorse. Yeah
And he's been doing it for like 20
forever summers.
So that was quite an experience for me. But we made it through.
Okay, so then finally, once it's time to start doing stuff for the track, like especially at the Nationals, you see how big those places are, and then you guys got to stake in everything and then stamp those banners, staple them in. How long does that take to make that track at a National look race ready?
I couldn't tell you like exactly. I don't know, it's hard to say. Like,
yeah, you don't have to have like an exact time, but that's a day, 2 days, half day.
Like to do like the stakes and the repeater and stuff like that. Yeah, we do it, we knock it out in pretty much a day.
Okay.
Day and a half, somewhere in there. So
okay, that's impressive. And then you guys all through the day, like it's got to be so annoying on Friday or Saturday morning, you know, on those first laps when some guy gets whiskey and then just goes flying through the banners and then just disintegrates them. And then you guys have to run to go staple new ones back up. Like when I see you hustling, especially during the races, when it's like peak hot, like Bud's Creek's 95 degrees and there's no wind, and then someone just went off track, you guys are there in like 35 seconds. Like there's never a moment missed. So they're radioing to you to get those banners up, huh?
Yep. Yep, we're on standby for repeater fix. So
they're serious about the banners, because this is all the time. Like even in Supercross, like you guys are like, hey Anton, you gotta move. So I'm like, I know. Okay, so then Saturday at the races, you know, especially for a National, I think when I get there, I'm like, oh man, we're getting there early. But what time do you guys get there? And then how long is the day? Because you're not done until almost dark even.
Yeah, we usually start, it's probably like 7 or 8 o'clock in the morning, just to make sure everything's good. Because I mean, we'll get the repeater banners and everything done the night before, and no telling what the weather was like. So we have to get there and make sure like stakes didn't fall over, you know, banners missing, whatever. Mm-hmm. So we'll work on that. And after the race is over, we pretty much tear down until probably like 10 or yeah, I'd say somewhere like 10, 11 o'clock at night. And then we'll finish it out the next morning. Like we pretty much get everything torn down and then just load up everything on Sunday. So.
Okay. And then on the road by Sunday afternoon?
Yep.
Okay.
And we hit the road and head to the next one. So.
Okay. How does Supercross compare and contrast to that? Because obviously like you guys are in a much tighter area as far as the building goes. And, you know, you're not going over the elevation and all that other stuff. But at the same time too, then you have security and then you have all these other things that you're working in on those parameters. So what's a Supercross build week like?
Supercross week, we get there Tuesday, or we fly in on Sundays, but we get the day off on Monday, and then we'll start building everything on Tuesday, get everything lined out. And it varies week by week, just depending on like where Dirtworks is at on the build and like what we can do. But towards the end of the season, I was getting to start on the podium right away, which was awesome because podium's pretty crazy build for me. So, throughout the week, we set the finish line usually on the first day, and we'll get it like pre-built to where we can finish it the next day. And we got to where we were doing pretty well towards the end of the season, and everything was pretty much race ready either Thursday or early Friday. So
okay, you said you guys fly in for the Supercross stuff?
Yeah, so for the California rounds this season, we took a bus. If it was just a short trip, we all just loaded up on a bus. And but for some of the races that were farther apart, we flew in.
Okay, good. That's good to hear, because I was figuring like, man, that would just be a grind to just be, driving all the time. So you'll just fly on, Sunday morning from the city that you were in to right to the next one.
Yep. But with Supercross, it's crazy because our loadout, like we have to finish everything,
that night. Yeah.
Yeah. After that race. So like we'll get there 8 o'clock in the morning on race day, ready to do the race. We'll chase after bikes all day. And then once the race is over, we start tearing down, and we may not finish until 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock next morning, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
So it's.
What time would your flight be on a Sunday then? Like, are you later in the day?
Sometimes, like there's been a couple times where it was just like, maybe 3 hours in between like us finishing and then we have to fly out. I mean, there's a few times where I was like, yeah, I'm just not going to go to sleep. I'll sleep when I get on the plane. Mm-hmm. So,
dude, the how fast you guys tear down blows me away, especially at a Supercross, because like I'll do the podium and I can already see, like, as soon as the bikes cross the finish line for the 450 main event, stuff's already getting cut. Like, banners are getting cut down. Tough blocks are starting to get stacked. All the wires are starting to get spooled back up.
Yep.
And then I'll go do, how was your weekend? Or I'll do the press conference and I'll go back and get my equipment from the photo den. And that might be an hour and a half, not even that long at all. By that point, pretty much every tough block has been stacked in one spot or taken back to the rig. And then almost every piece of dirt is in one pile in the middle of the track. Like, how fast you guys really do tear everything down is unbelievable. And then to see how it is built up, like when you guys, like you said, when you walk into a track on Saturday, you don't know like all the stuff that goes into it, but then to see all the modular pieces, like the scoring tower, the finish line, the podium, that's gotta be just like one big erector set to just put together every week. It's cool to see how all that stuff is like packed up into those rigs and then just sent down the road, because there've been times that I've been driving back from races that I'll follow the rigs out. And I'm like, I think I know what's in that truck. I think this is this one. Or I think that it's cool to see like all the little infrastructure pieces, because like you said, for two dudes like us that just want to know all the little secrets, like that's the super, super cool tech stuff where you're just like, this is how the whole show happens.
Yeah. It's crazy to think. I mean, it's just like the outdoor situation for me, like showing up and you're used to just being a finished product and I get there and it's like, there's so many things that go on with Supercross. Like just, just the things that you wouldn't even think about, like the DJ setup for this year. Like, we had to build a deck, but we just didn't know what location it was going to be every week. So we're sitting there like trying to plan all that out, and it's just like so many different things that come into play, and it's like, it's crazy.
It's been fun to talk one-on-one with people like Dave Prater, Kerry Hart, Andrew Baccarosa, Bruce Sternstrom, Jeff Crutcher, and Ryan Ragland about whatever I want. And that's thanks to everyone at Yoshimura R&D for supporting this feature. Check out Yoshimura's website and social media accounts for more great content.
The big thing for you, though, like, you do all the grunt work and you do all that manual labor, but then Saturday comes and then it's time to put on the official shirt and then you have the helmet. So what is harder, being the track worker or being the manual labor side?
For the manual labor's the tough part, but there have been certain situations like on the track that's just been crazy to me, like just, you know, crazy stress. Like just because I mean, you're out there, and when I had my first interview, he was like, hey, how comfortable do you feel being close to the track? And I'm thinking, like, I'm a video guy, like I'm always close.
I'm good.
To the track.
Yeah,
no worries. And then you go out and, you know, there's guys wrecking, which in Supercross, like for people that don't get to watch it on TV or that are not at the track,
there's a lot of wrecks.
There's wrecks all the time.
All the time.
Everybody. All the time.
Dude, and even if they don't wreck, like somebody goes off sideways and then like knocks a tough block out, that then you guys have to run out onto the track to straighten up or something like that. Yep. Yeah. There's always something.
You have a guy yelling at you on the radio, like, mm-hmm. go get this tough block, or this rider's down, go protect him. And it's mm-hmm. just like, it's just chaos.
So then how did you get into that position? This year was the first year you really did that into the level that you had, right?
Well, I was a track runner as well.
Last year?
Last season, yep.
Okay.
But yeah, it was just, I mean, that's just part of the gig. I mean, everybody pretty much helped set up, and then we do the track running as well, so.
Okay. So how do you like that? Like, I'm sure that that feels like a whole different set of responsibilities for a guy like you. You know, when you're a photo guy or when you're the track guy, you're like, okay, I want my photos to look good, or I want the track to look good. But then when it comes down to that, the race and another person's safety is really in your hands, you know, right. Like making sure that everything goes well. That's got to be a lot of pressure. And then, like you said, you have that helmet on, but then there's constantly somebody in your ear telling you what to do. Jim Perry's always telling you where you got to go.
Yep. I mean, it's just, I enjoy it. Like, I get a rush out of it, but there are times where it's just like, you know, there's some guys that are wrecking out on the track that I'm friends with, or, mm-hmm. you know, Kyle Peters was one of them, mm-hmm. when he got injured. Like, I got to film with him on the Cross and Honda team. And it's just like, it's kind of a hard position to be in, because that's like somebody that I, you know, I'm friends with. But yeah, it's just, I don't know how to really explain it. It's just crazy for me to be out there. But yeah, I don't know.
Are you ever, okay, so like with the bike thing, like they're so on us about where we can and can't go on the track, and totally understand, like there's places that that when I see the track map access for the photos, I'm like, wow, I can't believe that's green, but that's red. Like, that makes sense.
Yeah.
And we're still far away. Like, you guys still want us a bit off of the track limits and stuff, but you're right there. So is it ever like nervous? Like, how close have you been to getting like T-boned by a bike? Has it been pretty sketchy, or has it been okay?
Well, this last season, I got hit by a rider in St. Louis.
It was
I was in the sand section, which I didn't get like slammed anything, but just got, you know, kind of knocked over. But I think I want to say it was like San Diego. There was a tough block that just kept getting hit, and they kept calling me to go over and get it. And the way the track was set up, there were like two turns pretty much against each other, and I had to like jump in the middle of that, and there's riders coming from both directions, like hitting it, and I just felt like I was like sandwiched in between. I was just like, I hope this shows up on TV, because this feels really crazy. But yeah, there's been situations like that that's just like, man, this is pretty wild. So
at San Diego, I have that photo of you helping Chase out do opening ceremonies, and I didn't know that you had been doing that yet. You know, I see how much stuff you're involved in, but that one had to be cool for you, because I'm sure you like Chase, like Midwest guy.
Oh yeah.
Super polite, really, really nice kid. To see you kind of have that moment when I like looked over, I was like, oh fuck yeah, there's Alec. This is sick. How fun has that been to have the people that are in charge of your job see like how good you are at it, and then to give you additional responsibilities, because they know like Alec's not a kook. He's going to go through with this perfectly. That's honestly been the biggest thing of these last 2 years, where I'm like, dude, Alec has killed it, because they're giving him this stuff. You got that award the other day, but seeing the interaction that they're having you have with riders and other people at high level decisions is pretty cool.
Yeah. This season has been awesome. I remember having a talk with my boss Bill, and he was just like, I really need you guys to step it up this year, because we're bringing in a new group of people. And, I just remember, like, I had that mindset. It was like, I have to step it up this year. And there's, you know, there's so many things that I want to accomplish. And like I said, they added quite a few things to my plate. And I just wanted to run with it and just do the best I can. And it's cool because like opening ceremonies, I did opening ceremonies last season, and but this season they gave me a few more riders and just a few more things to help out with, which was awesome. The first time I did opening ceremonies was Houston last season, and I had Osborne and Wilson, and
so two just dudes just talking. Zach can be quiet, but he's like real into it. But then Dino's always cracking jokes, so that had to be fun for you.
Well, here's the situation. They had a section blocked off due to COVID. Like, they didn't want people to work or walk in a certain section. And my tunnel was like right to the right of that. And they said, you can't go that way. So I'd have those guys walk all the way around the Houston stadium. And
just to go right there.
Just to go like 20 feet to the right. Mm-hmm. And so I was just trying to follow the orders and everything. And I'm walking with these guys all the way around the stadium, and they're annoyed. Like, they don't want to walk all this way. Like, I think Zach wrecked in practice, and he's like, man, I hurt my knee. Like, do I really have to walk all this way? And I'm like, I'm sorry, sir. This is my job. I'm just doing my thing. And
I remember that wreck too. That was the big one. Yeah.
Yeah. We got to the tunnel before the tunnel that I needed to get to, and security stops us. And they're like, you can't go any farther. And I'm like, what's going on? Like, this is my first job or my first weekend. And I'm radioing into my boss, is like, hey man, like, they're not letting me through. And luckily some of the fellow security guys helped me get through. So we get to the tunnel, and I'm talking to Zach, and I'm like apologizing to these guys, and Zach is like, oh, it's fine, man. Like, I tell you what, like, if I go win the main event, I'll give you a shout out for giving me a warm-up like before the race. Just like, you know, just joking around. And we hit the track, and he goes out and wins the heat race, and I'm like, oh my god, it's happening. But he didn't win the main, but I did send him a message afterwards. I was like, hey man, like, I'm sorry for that whole thing, opening ceremonies, I was trying to do my job. And he's like, hey man, like, it's cool. But he's like, I almost got it for you. And I was like, I know.
Dude, isn't it the worst? Like, when you know, like, you have to do something, and you have to tell these guys, like, bro, I have to be the bearer of bad news, but you have to do this way, because if you don't, someone else is going to make it my problem. So, like, sorry, but we got to do this. And especially last year when everything was, like, at level 10 for COVID at Houston 1.
Right. And, I mean, it's like the photo thing. Like, I'm getting called to tell you to, like, move over to get out of the banner's way. And it's like, I feel bad because I'm a photo guy. And I'm like, yeah, man, there's a great shot.
Oh, right, yeah, don't feel bad. Don't feel bad.
But you got to move you. So, yeah. Or we got to move you. So.
The cool thing that I've, like, in talking to you and Bill especially too, from the few conversations that he and I've had over the years, dude, there's so many guys that are out there too that I see, and we just chat up all the time. Everybody understands, like, how important this is. And there's a lot of mutual respect between us, the photographer guys, and you track worker guys, because we all know, like, we're all trying to do it for whatever reason. You know, we're all trying to do whatever it is. And then you guys have the stuff that you have. So, yeah, whenever you're telling me that I got to move, I never feel bad at all. You're good. With that responsibility, though, like, this year has been a big deal because, like you said, they said that this was going to be a new staff. So some guys that had been there with some experience needed to step up. What was that like for you to make that decision? Like, dude, I'm going to kill it this year. I'm going to make this my year. Because we hear racers talk about that all the time, but this is a similar mindset that we all go through. Like, I come into each year, like, I'm going to tear shit up this year. So it's cool to hear a guy like you is going to do it too.
Yeah. After the outdoor season, like, getting to take photos and stuff. And it was like the first time I was having photos published in magazines and stuff. And I was really excited about that. But I just had a few talks with Bill, and I'm just like, can I bring my camera? Like, is there any chance that, like, I could fit in some photos at some point? And he's like, oh, you know, bring your camera and see what happens. And, like, it just, like, flipped a switch. And I was like, I have to make this happen. Like, this is where I want to be. And I'm just going to keep pushing to, like, see what I can do. And, like, the first race we did press, and, like, everybody had to be on the floor so everybody can kind of get adjusted to, like, being on the track and stuff with a lot of new faces in the crew. And after that, I asked Sean Brennan if I could take photos during the next few press days, and he was cool enough to let me do that. And after that, I was just like, I'm gonna show up to every press and, you know, make a point, like, I want to be in this position. So which it worked out in my favor. I got to do a lot of cool projects outside of the build and everything like that. So, but yeah, I feel like I just flipped a switch and I was like, I really want to, you know, make sure that these people can count on me and just do as much as I possibly can to put myself in a better position. So
mm-hmm. I remember about midway through the Supercross season when on press days, you'd be like, hey, I get to shoot photos this week. I'm like, oh yeah, that's sick for Alec. And then seeing the relationship that you guys have built with a couple other guys, like you and Chiz are tight. Like I know Alec's getting Chiz's photos on Friday during press day, and that's gotta be a cool deal for you. How fun is it to do that and to see, like, I get to shoot photos where I've done all this work all week. Like it is a full project of your imagination at that point.
Yeah. It's the best feeling in the world seeing like all those riders share my photos and stuff. With Chisholm, like I filmed with him before Supercross shut down for COVID. I remember talking to you in Dallas. He was one of the riders that I emailed about filming, and I filmed all day, and then I was like looking back at the footage, just like, man, I didn't really get any interviews or anything. And I hit him back up and was like, would it be cool if I keep going to a few more races and just like film with you so we can like kind of build like a big video or whatever? And he's like, yeah, it's fine. Well, then COVID hit and shut that down, so I didn't get to do that, but I stayed in touch with him. And you know, I'm always rooting for Chiz. Like I'm one of the older guys, and I feel like ever since I've been watching, like he's been, you know, kicking ass. So so it's great to see him have a season like this. But I was just always trying to get photos out to him because I know that he knows that I'm trying to get in the media side of things. But it turned into like he's doing weekly updates with my photos from press, mm-hmm. and that's awesome. So but I've had a lot of riders, you know, give me credit online and stuff, and you know, getting those notifications and stuff. Like I said, it's the best feeling in the world. So, mm-hmm.
You know, when you shoot, there's a lot of people that shoot local stuff because I have people come up all the time that ask me stuff, and anybody that's watching, like, you ever have a question, hit me up. If I'm slow to reply, like, my bad, I'm sketchy, flighty like that. But as you shoot pro stuff, like you can see just like, they're so fast and they're on it all the time. It's almost hard to take a bad photo. Did you feel like your photo skills just ramped straight up because you saw all of these great guys in these perfect settings every weekend?
Yeah. I mean, I was pretty lucky, like in our area, like Kansas and Oklahoma and stuff. Like I was able to like drive a few hours and be around Trey and mm-hmm. you know, guys like that. But, yeah, definitely like Supercross setup. I mean, like you said, everybody's got like amazing form and just you know, it's
on. Yeah.
Easy jumps to work with. Like, mm-hmm. yeah, it's just, it's a cool setup. So I'd say it's a lot easier to be in that environment than just like going to a local race and trying to get, you know, great photos. But
mm-hmm. okay. What's the setup? What's your camera setup?
I've been using the same camera since 2012.
Have you really?
I was using a Canon Rebel T3i up until like a few months ago. I had so last outdoor season, I bought a Canon 90D, which, you know, isn't like a crazy upgrade from that, but it's, you know, it's a better camera. But and I got the, you know, Canon 70-200 lens, and that helped me out a lot. But I was just trying to dial in that T3i camera for as much as I could, and I definitely improved. And then this last outdoor season, I bought that other camera body. Well, I got a position where I was able to help out with like activation sponsors. I was mm-hmm. taking photos of just like the track and banners and stuff, like companies like Twisted Tea. And so it was kind of like a side gig, but I was scared to use the new camera because I hadn't even haven't used it at all. So I was still using Old Faithful. And I just got to a point where like I had the new camera body in my camera bag and I just wasn't using it just because I wanted to, you know, I knew it was safe. So
I feel you. I've done that a bunch of times on stuff. Like I know that like the good, like I have something new that I'm super excited to use, but I'm like, I'm not going to take the chance on it yet. I'm
yeah.
Just what I know. Yeah.
So halfway through the season, I switched to camera bodies. And once I started like kind of figuring it out, I was like, okay, like because I was questioning, I was like, maybe it's just my camera, like, if, you know, maybe I don't know as much as I should on camera. So, but it's getting better, and I'm, you know, I'm pumped on it. So
I like that you were smart enough to be like, oh yeah, I'm just going to do the side gig and take promo, like the activation photos. That's very smart. Like,
this is really why
I wanted to talk to you, is because like so many people, when they want this industry job, like we get all these emails and stuff, like, oh man, I'll do this. You really did put in the work, and you saw a lot of different avenues of like, I need to show where my value is to my employers or to potential employers or to the industry. Like, dude, I have to applaud you on that, because there's not very many guys that think that like, that's going to be the way. They think like, make a couple sick things on Instagram, or if I do this, or if I'm fast enough. But like, to see a guy really, really put in the work like that, like props to you, Alec, because that is so respected and so much what we need. Like, we need young guys like you just trying to do every single thing all the time. So good job, dude.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate that, man. That's
huge. I didn't know you did that activation stuff. And like, just to, on the advertising thing, like if a company like Twisted Tea knows that they need to see what we spend all this money to go to the Nationals, where, how does it look when we get there? Cause they're not going to have Billy Grotto go to Colorado.
Right.
If you take the photos and show like, well, this is what the banners look like. They then see a reason to keep going. So you're really doing a lot of stuff to continue the growth of the sport, even if you don't realize it.
Yeah. I was really pumped on that. And I mean, I definitely took a different route than most guys, but I think I appreciate it a lot more, like having to do all that build or doing the build all week. And then, you know, I'm just crazy thankful to be able to take photos, but at some point, you know, I'm only doing it on press for Supercross right now, but I mean, it's still just a dream come true for me. And
when I see you on Fridays, you make my weekend better for real, because I see how keyed up you are. Like if I'm like bogged down, or if I got like a ton of work and shit to get done, but I see how excited you are, and like I see how fun it is. Again, I'm like, yeah, dude, Alex, they're sick. Like Alex, yeah. Be about it. You've honestly, no kidding, dude. Like you've really gotten me through like a couple tough weekends, because I see how happy you are.
Well, I appreciate that.
That's cool.
I mean, I'm crazy thankful for the crew just like being cool with that. I mean, I always stress out about it, because I was like, I don't want them to think like I'm just getting, you know,
you're just trying to use them and then bail. Yeah.
Yeah. Like like the other track crew workers, like we're still setting up sometimes on Fridays, and it's like, okay, like I'm going to do this on my lunch break, like take photos, and then I'll be right back at it. But, some of the guys are just like, oh, Alex taking photos again. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, it's funny, because like the end of the season, we did like a slideshow of photos and stuff, and you could tell like those guys that were kind of giving me crap about taking photos, like they're loving the photos that they have. And on a side note, like I may be helping out their Tinder profiles as well.
Totally. You know, totally. And you're in a different city every weekend. And this kind of goes, which is a perfect segue into the next thing I want to talk to you about. What's life on the road like? Because you guys see it in a whole different way, and like you said, the group of guys that's in the van in the summer going everywhere. You guys don't just go like hotel, track, airport. Like you've gone and seen stuff. I know when you went to Salt Lake, you go around. When you went to Gillette a couple months ago, that's a big deal for you.
Yep.
And like you went on Belichick's birthday, so they gave you a cupcake.
Yeah.
You worked in so many of these cool little experiences where that's what the allure of the job is. It's like, yeah, I want to see the races, but then when you really get into it, it's like, wow, you get to see the world and you get to see all these great places. So what's that like for you?
It's amazing. I mean, I've always wanted to travel and do stuff like that, but when you get to these tracks, I mean, you'll work like crazy and then you fly in Sunday, and it's awesome, because I mean, just the group of guys that we have, like they're all trying to plan something. Like a lot of the guys are like, well, there's the sixth skate park that I want to go to on the day off. There's this, you know, there's this mountain view that I want to check out. Like we're all kind of like connecting together, like trying to figure out what places to go. And honestly, like we're all just beat to shit, just like worn out on Sunday. And then like Monday, like we should honestly just be like resting and, you know, recharging the batteries. But I feel like I'm more busy on the day off trying to cram everything in that I want to check out and then get right back into it. But it's just awesome to be able to travel all over and see all these places that I never would have seen if it wasn't for this job. So
What was your favorite place that you saw the Supercross season, like a view or a place you guys went to or an activity you did? Like, what was the highlight of that 17 races?
I was trying to think, like, it's hard to just narrow it down to one, but like I had a blast in San Diego. There's a lot of cool views there, and I've never been to that area, but Daytona was another cool one. That was a big race for me, because usually we don't send that many people on the crew. And last year I was pretty much begging to go to Daytona, and the guys that have been there for a while, they got to take that spot and I didn't get to go. And so this season I got to go and experience that. And it was a different setup, but it was still just cool to be in that environment during bike week and stuff like that. So.
Okay. What was the best meal you had?
Best meal? That's a tough one. I don't know. Like, I didn't really have anything that memorable this season.
Okay.
Last season, a bunch of us guys went to this like fancy steakhouse, and it was awesome. Like, it was amazing food, but it was just cool because like the whole Supercross crew went, and we get in this place and there's people in suit and ties and stuff, and we've got like Supercross shirts on, stained from the build. Yeah,
just, and you're still dusty and everything. Yeah.
Yeah. And the guy was like coming in to do like a whole spiel on like where their meat came from and all this stuff. We're just like just having the time of our life. So.
Okay. Travel essentials. What's in your backpack and your suitcase? Like, what do you have to have on the road?
I'm pretty simple guy. I mean, I had a lot of clothes and stuff, but it was like, I'm a t-shirt collector. So like every state that I would go to, I'd, you know, pick up a t-shirt, which made it pure hell trying to get back home this last round because I just had so many bags and stuff to carry. But I always carry a GoPro with me. Like, I've been documenting like these last couple years with GoPro, and I haven't really released much, but at some point I'm going to put it all together and just kind of document like my journey to be in the industry. And I'm excited to put that together at some point, but I don't know when I'll have the time. But yeah, like I pretty much just carry all my camera stuff with me, and that's pretty much it.
Okay. When you guys go to the gas station, like, what's the go-to snacks?
This job has put me back on the Mountain Dew. A lot of Mountain Dew to stay awake. Yeah, I'm pretty much just, I eat like crap on tour. That's for sure.
It happens.
Yeah.
Okay. Right now you're home. You're back in Kansas. Where you're actually doing this is your family's, like, mini storage place and like all that. So what are these weeks like when you're, you know, on hiatus, like between the work?
Yeah. So I help take care of the mini storage facility. My cousin Zach, he works here full time, and it's just him and I just run this, and he does it during the week, and I'm usually like on the weekends off. I'll cover for him on the weekends, but ever since I started doing these tours, he's just been working every day. So when I get home, everybody's like, oh, I bet you're ready for a break. I'm like, no, I'm going to work. But I mean, it's pretty easy job for the most part, and I like to give him a break because he's one of my biggest supporters, and for him to do this for me, I mean, we could hire somebody else, but it's just, this is how it's been for so long, just him and I running it. So but yeah, he's been supporting me, and it's cool that I have somebody, you know, rooting for me, and then when I get home, I get to work. So
yeah. I always think it's cool. Like, when you go home, you're always around your cousins, you're always around your whole family. That's really fun for me to see, because like, I'm home now and I get to see my whole family. And that's like the biggest thing, is like when you can just have the best of both worlds, you know, and it might not be a lot in one situation or the other, but like, then you get that perspective of like, man, I got it. So that's another thing where I'm like very pumped for you to have these weeks, especially how good these first like summer days are right now, and everybody you guys got around right now. So what are you going to do to make the most of this time before you got to jump back on the van?
just spend as much time as I can with the family, like my nieces and nephews. I love them to death, and I want to be the kick-ass uncle. Mm-hmm. But just getting to spend time with them, they're at that fun age where like anything I do is just awesome. So just want to spend as much time as I can with them, and you know, just try to enjoy time with friends and family, because doing both series, there's not much time at home anymore, and I'm so used to being at home. Like, I used to be just a weekend warrior type guy, so now that I spend as much time as I do on the road, like, I just try to take full advantage of just hanging out with family and friends. So
okay. I got like two more questions I'm gonna ask you, and if like, sorry, these are kind of personal, but you know, this is gonna show how much you really love this job. This, to work your ass off as hard as you do, I'm sure it's not like the most lucrative, like best paying job. I'm sure there's other, it's manual labor. I'm sure there's other people out there that are making way more money, but it's good enough for you. It's good enough for you to entice you to keep going out there. And then there's the allure of something else that's out there in the future. So what is it about this job that just makes you keep coming back?
Motocross has always been like my go-to, like even if I've had some really rough times, you know, like mm-hmm. loss in the family and stuff like that. But like motocross has always just been there for me. Like, it's just always been my outlet, like my happy place. So for me, it's just like, I even said I'm more in love with like the behind the scenes stuff than I am the actual racing. Like, I love the racing, but it's just like, these guys work their asses off to be here every weekend, and I just want to be a part of that. So, so for me, it's just, I just want to keep going, and I want to be a name like where, you know, people can look at me and just be like, this guy works his ass off, and like, he wants to be here every weekend. Like, that's awesome. So I just want to keep that going. And yeah.
Okay. Last,
I mean, it's not like you said, like, I'm not making a crazy amount of money. But yeah, I'm making, you know, I'm able to pay my bills, and I'm getting paid to travel around the world and watch the races that I normally spend all my money
to go to. Yeah. And you're fulfilled because you did it.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. Okay. The second thing would be the other day at the Supercross ending party, you got this really nice award, and it's very cool to see them like recognize all that you're doing. Like, I was very happy to see like that post by you and the little plaque that you got. I'm like, that's sick. Again, just like another big thing for Alec. To see where you're at in this position right now, do you want to keep going, and would you want to just like keep climbing that ladder of the track guy? Or like, if the media thing really came through, would you be like, I gotta go do that? Like, are you now caught in that balance of like one or the other?
Not yet. I mean, there's been talks like in the show office, like, we'll just, all of us guys will be talking, they'll ask me like, were you coming back next year? And there's some of my buddies that will chime in and be like, yeah, he'll be here next year, but it won't be in this department. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, which is, you know, a compliment, but I've let Bill know and other people know, it's like, I'm completely fine with building during the week. Like, that's not an issue. Like, I love being a part of it no matter what. But if there was an opportunity where I was able to take photos and just take photos, like, cool, I'm in. But there's not exactly a position where I can build and then,
and you then know, do like that.
Saturday off to be a photographer or videographer or whatever.
Yeah, and then not tear down. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So we'll see what happens. But like I said, I'm happy just to be there. And it's just been really cool to be able to, you know, do the extra things that I want to do. So
cool. Yeah, dude, it's coming. Don't worry. Like, you're doing it all the ways that you need to. And, you know, we'll put the word out there. Like, even if it's like, if I ever need you for something, you're going to be my first call. But if I know of anybody else, even if it's like a rival media outlet that needs like photographer for the weekend, you'll be the guy. Don't worry.
Well, I appreciate that.
Of course.
I mean, this season, it's just like, it's just a crazy feeling to me, because like, I've worked hard, but this season I've just like really noticed, like, I feel like there's, you know, something building, like, mm-hmm. something's brewing, but it's just like, all right, like, this is cool. Like, I enjoy that feeling and just, you know, the progression of it. So it's been awesome.
Okay. Very, very, very last question. What's it like for you when it's like 6:30 and then the lights go out? What's that like on a Saturday night? Like, do you still just like, oh my gosh, or is it, are you too busy to even register it?
No, like you're talking like opening ceremony.
Opening ceremonies. Like, yep.
Yeah. I still get that feeling like I did for the first one. And it's just, you just have to be like one of those guys on the floor to understand it. But it's just like, I love opening ceremonies. I mean, it can be hectic. There's people screaming at each other, like can't find the rider. It's, you know,
it's dark. Yeah.
Yeah. But it's, I don't know. It's just one of those things. That's just like, it's one of the best feelings, and like the pyro hitting and all that. It's just like you work your ass off all week. And then that's like that moment where you're like, this is the payoff. Like, this is so cool to see everything just take off. So.
Hell yeah. I love it, Alec. That's sick. I love it. This was perfect. I'm so glad that we got to talk. I can't wait to see you and Paula in a few weeks.
Yeah, man.
We'll have a blast this summer, dude. We're gonna have a good time. Yeah.
Sounds good, man.
Yeah. Well, hey, enjoy the time back home. Make sure to, you know, squeeze everything you can with the family and keep it going. And thanks for joining us for this midweek podcast. We'll have plenty more stuff going through, maybe in the middle of this summer. You know, once we get a couple nationals in and you got some work under your belt, we'll retouch and see where you're at.
Yeah, right on, man. Appreciate it.
Cool. Thanks, Al.
All right, thank you.